Okay, so now I want to talk about a common application of log functions in chemistry. The way we are going to use this most often in Chem 12 is to use it to convert an exponential function into a linear function or a line function. This is where your log operation is going to come in. So you're going to start with an exponential function, you're going to do certain manipulations using log functions, and at the end of those set of manipulations, you're going to get a line equation. The reason why we want to do this conversion from exponential to line is usually because the linear form of the data can be fitted fairly easily. And we'll talk about data fitting in a little bit more at the conclusion of this video. But you can fit the data with a method called the least squares method. And once you fit that data, you can then extract useful information that will give you an idea of what is going on in the system that you're studying. Like I said earlier, there are many, many different systems that display exponential behavior. A couple of them that we're going to deal with in Chem 12 would be reaction rates, which is kinetics, and then energy and equilibrium, which we'll discuss in the thermodynamics chapter. Both of this would require you to understand how to convert an exponential to a linear function. So again, the idea that we want to be able to get through is that we're going to have data that we collect, and the data would have a function that's represented by an exponential function of this form, y is equal to a times e to the power of bx. Remember, this is the function I mentioned in a prior video. And then what you want to do is take this function and convert it into a line equation. And of course, you remember from your math class that a line equation has this form where y is equal to mx plus b, with m being the value of the slope of the line and b is the y-intercept of the line curve. Now let's discuss an example that we talked about in a prior video, which is the compound interest calculation of a savings account. And remember, we talked about this in video 1. Remember that in that function, I asked you, or I told you, that you can calculate the final balance of a savings account if you have a certain interest rate and you put that money in that savings account for a certain number of years, starting with a particular initial balance. And that function is the exponential function, y equals a times e to the power of bx, where b is the interest rate and x is the time the money stays in the savings account earning that interest. At the bottom left of the screen, you see that those are the calculations that we did. Those were the numbers we started with in that particular problem, 125% in 10 years. And what we get is 196.85 at the end of 10 years. So in other words, I can write a general equation for this particular compound interest example by saying that y is equal to 120 times e to the power of 0.05x, where again, x is time, and y is the final balance. Once I have this function, I can go ahead and plot final balance, y, as a function of time, which is x. If I do this in Microsoft Excel, this should be the plot that you'll see. So you can see here's final balance, and here's number of years. What I did was just calculate for every year, from year 1 to year 40 approximately, what is the amount of money I'm going to get at the end of that year. So you can see that it has this shape. This is what we call an exponential shape. And of course, we know that because our function is an exponential function. I want to remind you here that you should be able to do what I just showed you in Excel, because we learned this in Chem 11. For those of you who forgot or have never taken Chem 11 before, you should come and talk to me to figure out how to do this. The question, though, that you most often see in chemistry in practice is that you know you have a data, and your data has the following form, y is equal to a times e to the power of bx. However, you don't know what a is, and you don't know what b is, unlike in the previous example with the compound interest calculation. So what you're trying to figure out is, what is a and what is b? Now, a and b are useful pieces of information most of the time because, for example, one of the equations that have this form would tell you that A is actually the frequency of collision of particles, reactant particles, and B is actually the energy that would be needed for a product to form as a result of that particle collision. So in other words, these are useful information that will help you understand a lot more about the reaction that is going on. Okay, so consider the following situation. You do an experiment and you get some data out of your experiment from a particular reaction where you measure concentration of product, which is plotted on the y-axis, as a function of time, which is plotted on the x-axis. You plot this and what you get is a plot that looks like this, okay? Which is of course the same as the plot that I just showed you in Excel in the prior, this plot right here. Now the only difference is that one curves up, the other one curves down, but they're both exponential functions. Again, based on your knowledge of math, when you look at a shape that looks like this, it immediately tells you that it's an exponential function, which of course has the form y equals a times e to the power of bx. The question is, what is a and what is b? That's what we have to figure out. Some or most of you know that at this point, if I want to figure out what a and b are for my data right here, I have to find an equation that has a shape that is identical to the shape of my data. This is what we call data or curve fitting. You should remember this from Chem 11 because this was the first lab that we did in Chem 11. So how do you fit a data? Well, to fit, you have to use a different series of equations, but we know this shape is an exponential shape, so we're going to start with y is equal to a to the power of times e to the power of bx, and then what we're going to do is we're going to substitute in various values of a and b. For example, let's say I try a combination of a and b, I call a1 and b1 here, and it turns out when I use that particular values of a and b, what I get is this red plot right here, which clearly doesn't fit my data. My data is right here, my red plot, which is my model, is right here, so it doesn't fit. So in other words, this a1 and b1 values are not correct. I have to try other values of a and b. I try the green one here, and I find that they're a little too low in comparison to the actual data, so again, a2 and b2 are also incorrect. I try a third one, which is shown as purple, A3 and B3, and that approximately fits the data reasonably well. That's pretty much what you're going to get in an experiment. And as a result, this is the mathematical functions with A3 and B3 that would best model the data that I collected. Now, as you can see, data or curve fitting is a really cumbersome process. It's really a trial and error type of process. And it's really hard to do with something like an exponential function. But it's actually a lot easier to do if you have a line function or a linear function. The reason for this is because people have studied linear functions for a long time, and then they've developed a lot of different methods to fit data that start looking like a line shape. So one of the most useful method to do this is something called the least squares method, which is basically a statistic-based method. So if you've taken statistics, you've probably heard of how to do least squares fitting. We did this as well in Chem 11, and the reason we could do this is because a lot of programs, for example Microsoft Excel, can do this automatically and fit your line data, linear data, by a line equation using least squares method. So then again, what our goal is to start with data that looks like this, and using log somehow convert it into data that looks like this, and once we have it in this form, then we can use least squares method to fit that data and get an equation out of it, and that equation will then tell us something about the system that we're studying. Let me now show you how you can do that. First, we started with this function y is equal to a times e to the power of bx. What we'll do is we're going to take a log of both sides of the equation, which is just becomes log y and then log of the entire thing right here. Okay? Now, using the property of log, we can say that this is log of a plus the log of e to the power of bx. And then, using that power property, we can take log a plus bx being put right here times the log of e, and then the log of e, if this is ln, will just be 1. So in other words, at the end, you're going to have log of y equals to log of a plus bx. Now again, this should all have a base number of e here. So if there's a little mistake in this slide, I should write ln for all of these guys. So the question then is, why is this form of the equation useful, the one that we got from the prior slide? Well, it's useful because I can write it in the following form. Log of y is equal to bx plus the log of a. If you put the line equation form y equals mx plus b right below it, you can see that each one of these things is mapping to a certain component of the line equation. The log of y is just y, b is now the slope, x is still x, and then log of a is your y-intercept. So in other words, what I've done is basically convert an exponential function, which has this form, y is equal to a times e to the bx, to a line equation, which is y equals mx plus b, by taking logs. And the way I do that is I would plot, instead of y versus x, I would plot ln of y versus x, and what I would get would be a line that has this form, where the equation of a line now can be fitted using Excel, for example, and I'll get slope. That slope will then equal the b value of my initial exponential function, and my a value of my initial exponential function can be calculated because the y-intercept of this line is equal to ln of a. So then a would just be equal to e to the power of the y-intercept. So again, just as a refresher, let's say this is your data initially, and you're trying to figure out, well, what exactly is the correct a and b values in the exponential function that would fit this particular data. First, what you need to do is take this data and convert it into a linear form, which I can do if I plot the natural log of the y-axis versus the x. So you see the previous function, which is exponential, has now been converted to a line equation. It's pretty clear that this has a line or linear shape. Now in Excel, I can easily fit this. You just look at this. You take the data point and you just go to, you can right click on this and then just say add trend line, and you can fit it with the linear form. Click close. And there you go, it fits it there. Now, of course, what you want is the equation of this line. So you can then say display equation, display R squared value, which you learn in Chem 11, gives you a feel of confidence of how well this fit works. And you close it, and you can see here at the top, there is an equation of this particular line. And the equation is y is equal to 0.05x plus 4.7875. Now, if you remember, this function originally started with my compound interest, which is this thing right here. And remember, I knew from this function, because I generated it, that the interest rate is 5%, and then the initial value of the investment is 120. Those are my b and a values, b of the exponential function and a of the exponential function. You can see now that when I convert this to a line equation, my equation now has the line equation y equals mx plus b, but what I said earlier was that my slope should exactly be the value of b. Now remember, what I just said is that the value of b, the interest rate, is 5%. Now you can see the slope value here is also 0.05, which is 5%. So in other words, this is really the method that we use a lot to help us figure out what is the a and b constants in an exponential equation, is to first convert it to the line, fit it with the least squares method, and then you would look at the slope and the y-intercept, and those two numbers will help you figure out what the a and b constants in your exponential equation is.